Welcome to Talentwise, the definitive podcast for CXOs, human resource and learning and development leaders. This show comes to you from thought leaders who talk about human capital development in today's organization. How to engage and empower today's employee to be effective, competitive and relevant. Stay with us for an exciting conversation with our guest and learn how to future-proof your team. I'm your host Shubhanjan, founder of Knowledge Bridge. Our guest today is Ravi Mathur, founder Ncash.
The biggest reason I see there is that a lot of people fail to understand the difference between training and learning. Training is an event. Learning is a process. Very many times people equate training is equal to learning, which is not. So they end up doing the event, which is training, and then they expect the result of learning to automatically come out of that, which doesn't happen. And as I said earlier, it disappoints everybody. Now what happens is, in a two-day program, or forget about 2 days, even a five-day program, there is a limited amount of knowledge or skill people can gather. Now, the retention of that is the key. As a lot of research have suggested that typically after a month, only 10% of the learning remains with people and 90% is lost. Now that 90% is lost when there is no follow-up mechanism. If there is a robust follow-up mechanism, that 10% retention can go up to even 50%. 99.99% of the cases, there is no follow-up after the training program. And for the first 4 years of Ncash, we also believe that it is the client's responsibility, and our responsibility ends at when we have given them that, okay, this is the way you should do it. But later on, we realize that, okay, no, in this process, it's not only the client who is losing, but we are also losing, because in the long term, if the training is not giving them the impact, finally, we will also be penalized in the long run.
Ravi Mathur is the founder of Ncash. He has over 15 years of training experience and headed the training function for Mahindra Automobiles and a telecom major in India. Ravi has over 1,000 days of training delivery experience in India and abroad, and have been involved in end-to-end training operations, starting with training need identification and going on to solutions construct, delivery and transfer of learning analysis. Ravi is passionate about positively impacting people's lives and have worked with the top 100 companies in India across telecom, automobile, steel, cement, pharmaceuticals and textile industries. And now, on to this great episode with Ravi Mathur, founder Ncash. Hello Ravi, welcome to Talentwise.
Hi Shubhanjan.
Thank you for making time. Let's start at the beginning. Tell us a bit about your journey as the founder of Ncash and your previous experiences working at large corporates, industries, and also your current engagement with multiple companies.
With respect to learning and development, I've been part of learning and development for almost 20 years now. Last 7 years with the organization called Ncash, which few of us started in 2012. And as part of Ncash, which is a learning and development organization, we have done a lot of work for companies in automobile sector. We have worked for cement companies, retail, chemical companies, so various, almost all industries, we have done a lot of work. Prior to that, I have been part of learning and development function with Mahindra and Mahindra, before that with Airtel, prior to that with Reliance Communications. So have had various experiences at different levels in learning and development over the last 20 years.
Right. So from your vantage point, what are the major challenges that you see, and what impact does those challenges have on actually building a future-proof team, which is an essential component for any organization looking at a long-term future?
Most of the times, even today, when an HR manager or a functional head is talking about learning and development, they are more focused on present, and very rarely people are talking about or thinking future-proofing the team, which actually should be the core objective. So the challenges which you talked about, what are the key challenges? One challenge which I guess across industry most of the people are facing, both on the service provider side as well as the client side, is what happens after the training intervention? So training interventions generally go well, basis what people want. But what happens after that is something which has been disappointing in most of the cases. And I will talk more about it later, but let me just talk about a few more challenges which I see. Another challenge which we see is that at a lot of places, learning and development is seen as a HR role or the responsibility of HR to execute it. Whereas I feel personally it is the biggest responsibility of the manager to make sure that his team is trained. But managers are often not showing as much interest as they should. So there's a second big challenge which I see. A third, which is more on the service provider side, not on the client side, is a standard vanilla training program which they have created and which they try to fit at every place. And client not having enough knowledge about how to assess a training program, they end up buying it, and after that they feel that no, it has not given them the desired results. So these are some of the key concern areas which I personally feel.
No, so I understand. It is sort of like HR has to handle training. So this year, let's do 15 days of training. And HR is trying to tick off that, right? That let me get this 15 days done and I have checked my box and I'm done, because I have much more pressing things about attrition, about recruitment, about review, about increment to handle than bother about training. So let's touch on the first point you spoke about. That learning intervention is failing because there is not enough or appropriate follow-up.
The biggest reason I see there is that a lot of people fail to understand the difference between training and learning. Training is an event. Learning is a process. Very many times people equate training is equal to learning, which is not. So they end up doing the event, which is training, and then they expect the result of learning to automatically come out of that, which doesn't happen. And as I said earlier, it disappoints everybody. Now, what happens is in a two-day program, or forget about 2 days, even a five-day program, there is a limited amount of knowledge or skill people can gather. Now, the retention of that is the key. As a lot of research have suggested that typically after a month, only 10% of the learning remains with people and 90% is lost. Now that 90% is lost when there is no follow-up mechanism. If there is a robust follow-up mechanism, that 10% retention can go up to even 50%. So what I was talking about is the lack of follow-up mechanism. And that's precisely what we have also faced in our initial years. And very objectively, we thought that, okay, this is the client responsibility. So we have done a training program. We have told the client that it should be follow up. We give them the tools. We tell them this is the way you have to follow up. But 99.99% of the cases, there is no follow up after the training program. And for the first 4 years of NCASH, we also believe that it is the client's responsibility, and our responsibility ends at when we have given them that, okay, this is the way you should do it. But later on, we realize that, okay, no, in this process, it's not only the client who is losing, but we are also losing, because in the long term, if the training is not giving them the impact, finally, we will also be penalized in the long run. And that's where we have started some initiative from our side proactively, where we said that, okay, no, we are going to invest in your retention mechanism. And those retention mechanisms, so I can talk about a few things which we did. So we said that why the trainer should be connected with you for 2 days, why not for the next 6 months? So our trainer talks to every participant 15 minutes every month for a period of 3 to 6 months. We say why we have to connect with you only once a month. We should connect with you every day. So we create a social media platform with a group of participants, and our trainer, our technical team connects with them every day on a topic of the program which is related to it, and keeps giving them some updates which was either covered in the program or on not covered in the program. Third thing is we create convert the program in small capsules of videos, and we put it on YouTube and share that link with the participant, which they can use as and when they want. So with these three things together, we have been able to increase the retention of companies. So we have worked with a very, very large company in the cement sector, where even the CEO, when he got to know, he was happily amazed at how good the retention and actually the learning transfer was because of this methodology which we used.
So I understand what you are doing. What kind of similar efforts do you see globally? And number two, what kind of retention? Did you do any measurement to figure out that yes, the retention has gone from 10 to 30?
So to answer your first question, globally, there are two methods which are used. One is the trainer connecting with the participant for a period of maybe 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, depending on the program. And the second thing is what we call the blended learning approach, where after the program, there is a online training module which is given to the participant, which they are supposed to go through on their own. Now, but there is a catch. The first thing which has been used globally is used for very high-end executive programs. So it's not used for a mid-level program or a senior manager program. It is only used when the CFO, CEO's kind of audience is there. And that's where they use this mechanism, where obviously the companies are also charging high kind of fee for that. The other thing which is used more widely is the blended learning approach, but it is more the learner driven, which means that they have given the content is given to the learner, but it is learner's wish to go through that content. So the success rate of people actually weighing that content is very, very low. So hence these two mechanisms, while they are there, but they have very limited application.
Okay.
Answering your second question with respect to the impact we could see, yes, with the this cement company as well, and with also one of a very large tractor company which we are working with currently, where how these people with the help of the retain mechanism have not only improved in their behaviors, in their general skill set, but even the sales numbers which has grown.
Let's move on to the next point that you made. That is, typically the HR manager being in charge of training, there is a commitment issue, and that sort of impacts the growth of the team.
Let's take a quick break. When we come back, we will explore how managers are becoming the bottleneck in the development of their teams. Will it impact future readiness?
You are listening to a Show How To audio original. Podcasting is one of the fastest growing content marketing avenues today. We can help you exploit this largely untapped marketing opportunity. We can craft your audio strategy and leverage the wide reach and easy streaming capability that smartphone penetration provides. It is powerful and personal. Talk to us to find out how podcasting can help you build your brand and reach out to target audiences.
Welcome back. Before the break, I asked Ravi what he meant when he said managers' attitudes was one of the biggest bottlenecks in the development of teams. Let's listen into what Ravi has observed.
So future-proofing. So again, so you are trying to make your team future-ready, and as a manager, I should be the first person who should be interested in it. But what happens? So let me share our experience with a very, very large retail company. I would say one of the top three in India right now. We have been doing programs with them for the last 5 years, and every program is like 4.8 feedback on 5, 4.7 feedback on 5, and people are gung-ho after the program that, oh, this was the best program and everything. In spite of that, every program we get, we go and deliver, we are told that, okay, 20 people are supposed to attend this program. And we end up with 8 people, 5 people, 3 people. Now, the HR person who is coordinating continues to struggle, continues to call people, please come, the trainer is here, the program is about to start, and the first attendance is very, very low. Now, out of the five people who are attending the program, two people are called back by their manager in the next 1 hour. There is something urgent, leave the training program, come here, it is more important. Now, that's where I say the manager's lack of commitment. Now, your person is working with you for almost 300 days in a year. Can't you spare about 3 to 4 days for that person to learn in 1 year? If you can't do that as a manager, I think as a manager you are failing big time, because then you are only focusing on getting the task completed and not really investing on the development of your team member. Whereas the organization is making sure that there is an opportunity available to learn and grow, but the manager is, instead of becoming the enabler, is becoming the roadblock in the learning. So that's as I said, is one of the second biggest challenge which I see in future proofing your team.
So why does this happen? What is the psychology of the manager? Does he think that this is a waste of time, nobody's going to gain from this, and he doesn't have any empirical data? Or is it some kind of an ego that, look, I can teach them what is to be learned, so what is the point in some X person coming from outside and training? So where do you think this lies, actually?
So this lies at lack of planning. So the manager is aware of the training schedule 15 days in advance, but he is not able to plan things in a way where he knows that, okay, on that particular day or on those 2 days, I need to make sure that either I get that work done before those that day, or I do it after that. Now, on the program day, that person realizes, oh my God, this person was supposed to go for a training program today, but I have not planned that. So what is the easy way for me? No, I have to get the task done. So let me pull that person out. So I see the biggest reason being lack of planning at manager's end than anything else.
So that's the key, according to you. It's just a disorganized, sort of dysfunctional kind of leadership.
I see, because the managers, when we have asked the managers for the feedback of the program, they say, no, it was a wonderful program. My people are improving. They are doing well. But I think the short-sightedness of the manager is that they are more interested in getting today's work done rather than really investing in their learning and seeing that, okay, 6 months from now, 3 months from now, I will have a better employee.
Moving on to the last point that you mentioned in the beginning, where the onus, you say, lie in the trainer side or the training organization side, that they're trying to sell something which is fit all, but that in principle cannot work. And I presume that you are primarily focused on the sales function.
So when we say that one size fit for all, now, when I entered the training industry and I got exposure to various kind of training companies, their training programs, I was asked to sit and observe some of the training programs. I was supposed to support a particular trainer in some of the training programs. So let me tell you, I was excited and I was scared. So the reason I was excited was I thought there is a lot of scope where we can do some great job with respect to the kind of work we are planning to bring in. But I was scared. I was scared because the kind of methods which a lot of companies were using, if they continue to use that, most of the clients are going to lose their trust on learning and development organizations. And as an industry, we can't, we also would bear the brunt of it. So there's a reason I was excited and I was scared. So what's going on at multiple places is that there is a set. So for example, let's take an example, sales training program. So there's a sales training program. It's standard that these are the five things a salesperson is supposed to do. A company has developed that program. Now, there are five different clients. One is in, say, cement, other is retail, somebody is in automobile, somebody is a mobile company, an oil and gas company. Now, the same content is used with every client without understanding how the learners need, how the industry needs, how the company's needs are different in each case. Now, when the same thing is used, so there is one of the examples, I can't name that particular model. There is a very famous sales model, globally recognized, which is basically was developed for high-end B2B products. So it was developed for products which was like in the range of 3 lakh plus. Now, the same training methodology was used for people who are selling tractors, not realizing that something which was B2B is used as B2C, something which was used for high-end product is used for something which is a commercial use as tractors. Now, that is something which is again hurting the learning and development industry, the client, the future-proofing the team, all these aspects. So what I'm trying to say is that every program has to be different. Every program has to be designed based on that industry, that company, that learner. So that's where I see the third challenge as I talked about.
So let's go back to our core theme, which is future-proofing the team. So where do you think would be the disconnects where sales professionals of this generation would sort of miss the step and not be ready for a future which is technology-driven, which is buyer-driven, which is very different from the sales processes of the past 20 years?
So Shivanjan, let me take an example here. So as I know, actually you use iPhone, right? So if you go and to buy a new iPhone, the salesperson, irrespective of whatever he knows, will still get his success, because you as a person is already sold on the idea of an iPhone. And you will, irrespective of whether he does a good job, not so good job, you will go and buy that phone. And that person will meet his target, that person will get his incentives. Now, that's not future ready.
Not at all. In fact, I'll just interrupt for you for a moment. If I know I'm going to buy a iPhone, I'm not even going to the store anymore. I'm just ordering it online. So the question of this salesperson getting credit will, even if it is happening today, it will vanish in the next 24 months.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so what I am trying to tell you is that, so if you go to a Croma, keep knowing that, okay, you are going there to buy an iPhone, and there you meet somebody who is selling Samsung, and that person speaks to you, and that person makes you realize that no, iPhone is not what you need. Samsung is a phone for you. And then you end up buying that Samsung. Now, there is a huge difference in what the iPhone salesperson has done and what the Samsung salesperson has done.
Right.
The Samsung salesperson has converted an iPhone client to a Samsung. Now, that's what is future ready. Now, all of us will be able to sell to people who are willing to buy, or they have already bought our product before we meet them.
Right.
It's the challenge lies in converting the people who are not interested in my product, who are not considering my product, possibly in the top one or two options. That is what it is. So all of us will end up selling. That's not, because there are people who are interested in our product. So I think making the team future ready is, are you able to sell to people who are generally not considering you as the first two or three option? And that's, I would see as a differentiation between selling and being future ready.
My question still remains that how do you future-proof a sales team, especially in the B2B space? From your experience and from what you are seeing, where these industries are headed and where the ground reality in terms of quality of manpower, the quality of skill sets, the quality of training that is there, where do you see the directional thrust should be for companies to ensure that their sales teams are ready for the future?
Okay, so very clearly, most of the salespeople are focused on their own companies, their own product. This focus has to shift to my client company, my client's business, my client's needs. So the biggest differentiation with respect to getting future ready can come only when I am thinking like a client, when I am thinking from their perspective, and I stop talking about my product, my business, my revenue, and what am I going to get out of the deal. You will get something for sure from the deal, but till such time, the transformation from me to the other side does not happen. So that's where the key differentiator is, as you asked, that what is going to happen. If I start thinking that, okay, what my client needs, what are the things which my clients need, but they possibly he's not aware of. How do I, am I able to take out that implicit need which is there inside? I think that's the key transformative step.
Talentwise is brought to you by Knowledge Bridge. We produce customized and multilingual visual training content. We have worked on complex processes, products, and skills development for large blue chip brands such as Tata Motors, Mahindra First Choice, HomeLane, Epson, Toyota, Citibank, and Consul Neowatt, serving diverse industries. Talk to us for your next custom content requirement and be pleasantly surprised. Call us on 99 021 631 32.
Great. Ravi, thank you so much for your time. I enjoyed my chat with you.
Great. Thanks. Thank you very much, Ranjan. Same here.
I hope you had a good time too. And I look forward to hearing from you in the future and listen to more stories from the sales training space.
Thank you for being with us today on Talentwise. We hope we helped you focus on some actionable ideas today. It was certainly enlightening for us. We hope to see you again on our next episode. If you liked what you heard, subscribe to the show in your favorite podcast platforms like iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or wherever else you get your podcasts from, and give us a rating while you're at it. Thank you in advance. This Show How To Original podcast is produced for Knowledge Bridge, the multilingual visual training platform and custom training content creators by Show How To Audio. Hosted by Shubhanjan Sarkar and produced by Rajiv Aditya. See you next time.